his head. He wrote, "My people are being destroyed for lack of knowledge." If that was the case with the Hebrew people of the Old Testament, how much more does that devastating description of a people dying for lack of knowledge, how much more does that description apply to today's chosen people of God, the members of His one true church, the still nominally Catholic people? Today, my dear people, as you well know, for the past 30 years now, under the fraudulent Vatican II slogan of aggiornamento, updating, under that slogan, most nominal Catholics, and that includes most of your own relatives and friends, most nominally Catholics have been spiritually destroyed for lack of knowledge, as the old prophet Ozi used to describe it. Most so-called Catholics, that is the few who still bother to have anything to do really with the establishment, most of those people don't realize what has happened and what continues to happen to them. They, again to quote that old prophet, they are being destroyed for lack of knowledge. The sad part is, my dear people, that in most cases, that lack of knowledge of the lay people is not their own fault. Their lack of knowledge, the fact that the people don't know anymore what's right and what's wrong, what to believe and what not to believe, the responsibility for that rests squarely on the shoulders and the souls of their establishment spiritual leaders. Those leaders, who either themselves are ignorant, have become shepherds in the mist. They have themselves lost the direction. They have themselves lost the knowledge of things spiritual. Or worse, some of those leaders have joined, deliberately and voluntarily joined, that apostate church, a church establishment of apostates, that apostate church predicted by our Blessed Mother, both at La Salette and at Fatima, in such terms as a church, quote, in the hands of God's enemy, a church that is corrupt, no longer the home of the divine, the hunting grounds of Satan, Satan infiltrating the highest positions in a church fallen into darkness. That's the description of today's church, the description not made up by me, but given to us by the Virgin Mary, the Blessed Mother of God herself. And in that connection, my dear people, I think it will interest you to know that the Vatican's own official newspaper, L'Osservatore Romano, is now carrying a 6-article series dealing with the phenomenon of Satanism in contemporary society. My dear people, I have neither the authority nor the qualifications to set myself up in judgment over every individual member of the establishment hierarchy. It is up for you to conclude and up to God to judge which cardinals and which bishops are just unreliable, themselves confused shepherds, or which ones are outright false shepherds gone over to the camp of the enemy. I repeat, I have no authority to decide that. I repeat, you, the people, must conclude that yourselves, and God must judge them. But I have every right and qualification, my dear people, to say that what the Cardinal Archbishop of New York, John O'Connor, told the people at St. Patrick's Cathedral the Sunday before last, what he told those people about us, traditionalist Roman Catholics, what he told them about us was wrong, and was either the product of ignorance or worse. Since he, the Cardinal Archbishop of Manhattan, has all of our CTM publications in his archives. Obviously, our most recent quote-unquote must have touched the sore spot. How else explain that all of a sudden, on the Feast of Candlemas, no less, the Manhattan shepherd, in perfectly acceptable PC language, politically correct language, referring to us traditionalist Roman Catholics as, his words, extremists of the right, very PC language he used, he laughingly ridiculed us, telling his audience and the press that we reject his Novus Ordo masses. And by the way, I just saw an abbreviation in an official document from the bishops referring to the Novus Ordo New Order Mass as the N period O period Mass. And I figured it out. I said, that's good. You put that N and that O together and you end up with referring to the Novus Ordo Mass as a no Mass. You couldn't describe it better, Your Eminences. Thank you. So from now on, I'm going to refer to the no Mass. Now, the Cardinal ridiculed us extremists of the right, saying that we reject his no Mass and declare it invalid, simply, he said, because it is not said in Latin. Oh, come on, Mr. Cardinal, because that's how they address them now in Europe and even at the Vatican. Mr. Cardinal, come on, Mr. Cardinal. You know to tell that we declare you no Mass invalid just because it's not said in Latin. You know that is 100% false. You know that. Because, I repeat, you have all our publications in your possession. My dear people, for some 32 years now, over and over again, in our printed publications, on our audio and video cassettes, on radio and television, for more than 32 years, we have stated over and over again that the main issue at stake in our fight for the traditional Latin Mass, that the main issue is not the Latin language, much as we insist on that too, for very sound reasons. But the real issue in our fight for the traditional Latin Mass, the real issue is not the language, but the very survival of the valid sacrifice of the Mass, the renewal of the sacrifice of the cross of Calvary. That's the issue. Oh yes, we want the Mass in Latin, and for two very good reasons. Namely, the Church's continuity and the Church's universality. Latin is the symbol of those two values, the Church's continuity and the Church's universality. As our children who attend our monthly First Saturday Mass know by now, some know it by heart. That's the idea. We want to get it in there so it stays there when those children grow up. As our children already know very well, on the top of the cross on which our Lord and Savior died, his name And the reason for his death was written in three languages, Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. Jesus Nazarenus, Rex Judeorum, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Three languages. And that's why for almost 2,000 years we have used in our Mass no other languages but words taken from those three languages. Greek, such as Kyrie Eleison. Hebrew, such as the words Amen, Alleluia, Hosanna. But above all, Latin, the language spoken by our first Pope, St. Peter in Rome, and by all the subsequent popes for now almost 2,000 years. The old Rome, the Rome of St. Peter, spoke Latin, and the first masses offered in the catacombs were offered in Latin. The official language of all the popes who would succeed St. Peter. In other words, to preserve Latin, my dear people, in the Church's public worship, and especially in the number one act of public worship, the Mass, is to preserve the link between the Church of today and the Church of the past. We don't use a language in our Masses that only entered our Church 30 years ago. We use the Latin that goes back 2,000 years ago, because that is the link, the continuity with the Rome, the see of our first Pope. And our enemies know it. I remember during one of the talks I used to make all over the country, and a few other countries as well, 30 years ago, one of those directors of a liturgical commission in the diocese came up to me and said, Father, he said some nice things about me personally, he said, but I tell you, you are fighting for a lost cause, because, he said, we will not rest to fight you as long as there is one Latin word left in the Mass. And I asked him, why that hatred of Latin? He said, because as long as there is one Latin word in your Mass, that Mass will continue to smell of Rome. He didn't use the word smell, he used the more vulgar language, word, equally starting with S. And that is the idea, my dear people. The link, the continuity with the Rome of St. Peter, besides being a sign of historical continuity, of course the Latin language is also a sign of the Church's universality. No one insisted more strongly on that point, the need for Latin as a symbol of the universality of the Catholic Church, than Pope John the 23rd, who opened the Second Vatican Council. That good Pope in whose name all those abuses are supposedly justified. No one insisted more on having the Latin untouched than he did, making his own the words of all the popes before him, especially Pope Pius the 11th and Pope Pius the 12th, who clearly stated a universal religion must have a universal language. Just as Catholics are supposed to believe the same everywhere in the world, so they also must feel at home everywhere in the world, wherever they enter a Catholic building. I remember World War II, and you speak to any American Catholic boy who served in the services during World War II. Wherever they went, be it Europe, Japan, be it Okinawa, you name it, there was one place where the Catholic American GI always felt at home, and that was the local Catholic Church. When he went in there, it all looked the same. as where he came from. When he attended Mass, the same language, the same vestments everywhere. It's true, perhaps he did not understand every Latin word the priest said in Belgium or in Berlin or wherever. Maybe he didn't understand every Latin word. The priest never taught him how to follow the Mass in a missal. The priests were too busy back home organizing bingos. But even if he did not understand every word, it sounded exactly like back home in Brooklyn or in Kansas, wherever he came from. And he could really say, this is my church. And if he would notice that the priest had no altar boy that particular morning, he could go up and immediately start answering and serving. In Omnipatris et Filii, he would say, Amen et cum Spiritu Tuo. And again, it was his church, the universality of the Catholic Church, brought out in the use of the same universal language. And those American establishment cardinals and bishops who permit all sorts of languages in their churches. At one time you could go to any church, remember, and you knew exactly what you would hear there, Latin. Now you go to a church, if you are still that stupid, not you, but some of your friends, to go to one of those establishment churches in the archdiocese of Mr. Cardinal O'Connor, you don't know what you're going to hear. Because he brags about it, that the new Mass is, isn't that nice? That the new Mass in his archdiocese is now being said in no less than 26 languages. Albanian, Arabic, Armenian, Chinese, Croatian, French, French Creole, Haitian that is, German, Greek, Hungarian, Igbo, that's Nigerian they tell me, Philippine Tagalog, Indian, Italian, Korean, Lithuanian, Old Slavonic, Philippine Tagalog, Polish, of course, Portuguese, Russian, of course, Slovak, Slovenian, Spanish, Ukrainian, Urdu, I couldn't figure that out what that is, and Vietnamese. The universality of the church, no. The confusion of the Tower of Babel. Now those Catholic cardinals and bishops permitting all those new masses in those different languages with here and there a token spot where once now and then on a Sunday a so-called half-traditional, half-Latin mass is permitted, those bishops and cardinals are in open violation of their own law, including the law of the Second Vatican Council, to which they always appeal to justify all their abuses, because even their own Vatican Council constitution on the liturgy in Article 36 clearly states, quote, the use of the Latin language must be preserved. I know it's in there. I helped write the constitution in Rome. And if those same church tradition challenging and church law breaking cardinals and bishops perhaps wonder why, in spite of all their updated multi-language performances, why do their churches continue to become emptier and emptier? Take the tourists out of St. Patrick's Cathedral this morning and you have 20% of the pews filled. Why are they wondering why nothing is going right anymore with them? Their schools disappearing, their seminaries empty, everything, if they privately admit it, going wrong. Why? Let me remind them that already during the first Protestant Reformation, the Doctrinal Council of Trent put a curse on those bishops and cardinals of today by stating clearly, if anyone says that the Mass should be celebrated in the vernacular only, instead of in Latin, let him be anathema, cursed. And then, as we all know, subsequently, Saint Pope Pius V, he became later on, placed another curse on them when he told them, don't you dare to change one word in that particular Latin Mass from now on. they work under a double curse. A curse from a legitimate, real doctrinal council, Trent, and the curse of a saintly pope. How do you expect to succeed, Mr. Cardinals and Mr. Bishops? But, my dear people, as I stated, the main issue at stake in our fight for the traditional Latin Mass is not the Latin language. The very survival of the valid sacrifice, that is the issue. If tomorrow that so-called Mass presented on cablevision by a self-appointed priestess Angelica and her strange-looking clergymen around her and even stranger-looking nuns around her, if tomorrow their thing on cable television would be completely in Latin, and I mean real Latin, not that kind of funny-sounding Latin they throw in there now and then. If that thing on the cable television were completely in Latin tomorrow, or if next Sunday Cardinal O'Connor or Bishop McGann would conduct their new Mass completely in Latin under the pressure of some well-paying pressure group, if all this were completely in Latin, my dear people, we loyal Roman Catholics would still reject it, because a Protestant service conducted in Latin is still a Protestant service. Even when these half-half Latin Masses are now naively welcomed by some jolly-completely conservative traditionalists as a return to the good old days, or at least a step in the right direction, they say. My dear people, 22 years ago, in 1975 to be exact, urged on by some of the bishops and cardinals I advised in Rome during the Second Vatican Council, they asked me, you look into this and you tell us what you, as a doctor of canon law and moral theology and church history, and as a professor of 13 years experience and an advisor to us at the Vatican Council, they told me, you tell us what you think the reasons are that no Mass should be rejected. And I published that study, which most of you have. It was published in 1975 and since then reprinted continuously by popular demand, and right now again ready for another reprint. And it's easier for me to reprint, I don't have to change one word in it. So. Now, 22 years ago, I published this, and I made it clear why that no Mass was poison to be rejected as sacrilegious at its best and invalid at its worst. And during those 22 years, my dear people, I have challenged every cardinal and every bishop or any of their official theologians or canon lawyers to debate me. Any place, radio, television of their choice, or to debate me in any publication, magazine, newspaper of their choice. But they didn't accept that invitation, not only because they could not find anyone to match my professional and academic qualifications, they told me later on. But even more so because they know that what I put in there is exactly what the church used to teach for 2,000 years. As the professor of canon law and moral theology, I clearly explained, as clearly as I could, and as I tried to explain things for 13 years to my students preparing for the priesthood, I explained why that new Mass must be rejected on canonical grounds. And I gave them all the canonical canon law lingo available and must be rejected on moral grounds. And I gave them there also what they all heard at one time, I suppose, in their seminaries. But even more so, I made it clear why that no mass has to be rejected on dogmatic grounds. And here, my dear people, I no longer spoke as the professor, because no professor of canon law or theology is qualified to impose his views on the rest of the church. So when it came to explaining the dogmatic reasons why we say no to that no mass, I simply repeated and put in simple words the dogmatic grounds which had been made public to the world by no one less than the late Cardinal Alfredo Ottaviani, the greatest canon lawyer of the 20th century, I can assure you, and a man who at one time rose to the number two position in the church, directly responsible under the Pope and directly responsible to God for the soundness of Catholic doctrine. That holy, simple, but tremendously impressive cardinal whose personal friend I became, who was hailed even by the current Pope John Paul II at Cardinal Ottaviani's funeral as the rock of Gibraltar of the church's soundness of doctrine. He is the one, my dear people, who gave us the dogmatic reasons why that no mass cannot be accepted. First in a letter to Pope Paul VI and to all the bishops of the world, which he sent on September the 3rd, 1969. And then, when no answer to his letter was received, he then made that letter public to the present, to the world, on October the 15th, in 69 already, my dear people. 20 cardinals and 100 archbishops and bishops had promised Cardinal Ottaviani to add their signature to the original letter before its publication. Bishop Blaise Kurtz at that time was confined to the hospital, and the Ottaviani letter never reached him. That was done through some tricky maneuvering, I'm sure. I didn't get it. It was mailed to me, I didn't get it. It was mailed to Bishop Kurtz, he didn't get it. Can't blame the post office for that, I'm sure you. Now, 20 cardinals and 100 archbishops and bishops had promised him, you make it public, the rejection of this no mass, and our name goes on there too. My dear people, at the last minute, 19 of those 20 cardinals chickened out. And each and all of those 100 bishops and archbishops, including one Marcel Lefebvre, chickened out. Only one other cardinal, Cardinal Antonio Bacci, at that time in history, the archivist of the Vatican Curia, he honored his given word. And future historians will record that those two cardinals, Ottaviani and Bacci, were also the same two Roman cardinals who had previously approved the manifesto of the Catholic Traditionalist movement. And me personally, Cardinal Ottaviani, as early as February the 5th, 1965, with Cardinal Bacci joining him in this on March the 14th, 1968. My dear people, those dogmatic reasons, I have them all explained in that study of mine, they make it clear that no mass must be rejected, as what Cardinal Ottaviani, and repeat, he is the man responsible for the soundness of doctrine at that time. He said we must reject it on no less than 26 dogmatic grounds. This no mass, which he called an inculcable error, must be rejected, I repeat, on 26 dogmatic grounds, calling it, among other things, a denial of all Catholic claims to be the true church. A denial of all essential values of the Mass, especially when even the words of consecration of our Lord have been falsified. A service satisfying the most modernistic of Protestants, with the priest's role minimized, changed, and falsified into nothing more than a Protestant minister. That shouldn't surprise us at all when Cardinal Ottaviani said, that's no longer a Catholic Mass, this new thing. This is a Protestant table service. That shouldn't surprise us, my dear people, since the new Mass was composed by a committee of so-called experts, five of them being Protestant ministers, cleared by the World Council of Churches. What do you expect them to come up with? No, Mr. Cardinal of Manhattan, and you other cardinals and bishops like him, those traditionalist extremists of the right do not condemn your gnome as a sacrilegious at its best and invalid at its worst, because you do not say it in Latin. We reject your mockery of a real Mass on the same, I repeat, canonical, moral and dogmatic reasons the Rome of Cardinals Ottaviani and Baccio did reject them, when they publicly refused to have anything to do what they despisingly described as your new liturgy, Mr. Cardinal, which they described as, quote, the delight of the different groups who, hovering on the verge of apostasy, are wreaking havoc in the Church of God, poisoning her organism. They asked me, what nerve have you got to call the new Mass poison? I didn't use that word first. Cardinal Ottaviani used that first. Thank you, Your Eminence. Wreaking havoc in the Church of God, poisoning her organism and undermining the unity of doctrine, worship, morals, and discipline in a spiritual crisis without precedent. My dear people, in the beginning of this sermon I quoted the words of the old prophet Hosea, my people are being destroyed for lack of knowledge. Applying them to most of today's nominal Catholics who continue to be spiritually destroyed for lack of knowledge. They don't realize what has happened and what continues to happen to them and to their children. It's different with us, my dear people. You and I and a handful of faithful Catholics like us here and there, dispersed in the diaspora, you and I, we have been given the Holy Ghost's gift of knowledge, the gift of understanding what's going on in the world and in the Church in particular, the gift of seeing the truth, that truth of which our Lord himself said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. God's eternal truth and God's children's freedom. Oh, what a double treasure, my dear people. And to know that that treasure is ours, yours and mine. And my dear people, strengthened by the grace of God's very own sacrifice of the Mass, protected by his mother's scapular and rosary, and covered by his Archangel Michael's shield, we, my dear people, we have what it takes to stop Satan, no matter in what colored robes he masquerades, to stop Satan, as our Lord did in today's gospel, to stop Satan from taking that treasure of ours away from us. So be it.